we present the sixth in the series of BBC Reith lectures on the Englishness of English art, given by Dr. Nikolaus Pevsner. In this lecture, Dr. Pevsner deals with Constable and the pursuit of nature.
Constable never visited Italy, nor did he visit Paris. Neither did Blake, neither did Gainsborough, neither did Hogarth. I don't think Constable seriously wanted to know Italy. There is a letter of his about someone's mind and talent mouldering away at Rome. And in an address to students of the Royal Academy, he warned them not to be in too great haste to seek instruction in the schools of France, Germany, or Italy. Yet he was an ardent worshipper of Claude Lorrain's Italian landscapes. And he once wrote to his friend, Archdeacon Fisher, that he feared he might be doomed, these are his words, doomed never to see the living scenes that inspired the landscapes of Claude. That seems to contradict what I said just now. However, the passage immediately goes on like this. But I was born to paint a happier land, my own dear old England, and when I cease to love her, may I, as Wordsworth says, never more hear her green leaves rustle and her torrents roar. Constable loved his country, and if such love can be taken as an indication of frank, of naive Englishness, then Constable ought to be as promising a case for my purpose in these lectures as Hogarth, who signed himself Britophile, and as Blake, who called himself English Blake. Blake and Constable are contemporaries, and they are what Blake called contraries. They have indeed hardly anything in common. Constable and Hogarth can more easily be compared. Nature is simple, plain, and true in all her works. Constable could have said that, but in fact Hogarth did. By a close observation of nature, the artist discovers qualities which have never been portrayed before. Now, Hogarth could have said that, but Constable did. And who would you guess said at the beginning of his career, there is room enough for a natural peinture? Actually, it was Constable. Now, Blake, on the other hand, said natural objects always do weaken, deaden, and obliterate imagination in me. But now, to return to their Englishness as it appears in their art. Blake's Britain is a dim, druidical Albion. Hogarth's Britain is the noise and bustle of London. Constable is the English countryside, and more specifically the Suffolk countryside, where he grew up, the son of a miller. There his art, as he said so truly, his art is to be found under every hedge and in every lane. So is, of course, Hogarth, under every pub sign and in every alleyway of London. But there the comparison ends, for Hogarth is a storyteller, and Constable is emphatically not. And Hogarth wants, as Garrick once put it, to charm the mind and through the eye correct the heart, whereas Constable had no such extraneous program. He contradicts thereby what I put before you when I talked about Hogarth's reporting, namely the English artist's literary leaning. But the contradiction is only on the surface, and it can largely be solved by a look at the change in the whole of Europe between the age of reason and the age of romanticism. Observation remained, but it was no longer the observation of man in his actions, but the observation of nature. Nor was it any longer so much the observation of man simply in his likeness. That is to say, portrait went on, of course, but painters of the highest talent, who in the 18th century had concentrated on portrait, now went into landscape. The years between just before 1800 and about 1840 saw a prodigious flowering of landscape painting in England, unparalleled in any one country on the continent. The development starts, of course, in the mid-18th century when Richard Wilson came back from Italy and turned from the idyllic landscapes of the South to English and Welsh landscape. Gainsborough, I told you, preferred painting landscape to painting portraits, and his landscapes have indeed the happiest insouciance of handling and the most enchanting tenderness of sentiment. Even bolder is the handling of Alexander Cousins's landscapes. For their groundwork, they have ink blots crossed by an accidental network of lines which he created by crumpling the paper and smoothing it out again before the blots were made. The result has a breadth of vision and a sense of atmosphere prophetic of the 19th century. Alexander Cousins even made special cloud studies, just as Constable was going to do later. But there is yet a fundamental difference between Constable on the one hand and Wilson, Gainsborough, Cousins on the other. Even Alexander Cousins' son, John Robert Cousins, whom Constable once called the greatest genius that ever touched landscape. These masters of the 18th century have in their compositions and their stylish handling of the brush still a self-consciousness which reflects the century's sense of superiority over nature. Nature must be composed. Nature must be improved. In this, the landscape painters actually agreed with Reynolds. And incidentally, they agreed with the improvers par excellence, that is, the 18th century landscapers, to whom I shall come later. Now, all that changed with Thomas Girton, who died young in 1802, and then with Crome and Constable. Their world is the English everyday world. Their theme is atmosphere. The technique they use to interpret an ever-changing nature is open and sketchy. Now, this preeminently painterly technique was not created at that time, nor was it created in England. It's the direct descendant of Venetian 16th century painting and then of Baroque painting, especially in Holland. But in England, it appeared out of the blue with Hogarth. But he, as you know, didn't want to be a painter primarily. He wanted to be a teacher of morality, just as Reynolds wanted to be a teacher of classical culture. Hence, both wrote on the theory of art as well. Gainsborough was not interested in theory, interested in general ideas. And that is why Reynolds blamed him, in spite of his respect and a sensitive appreciation of his technique. The wording of Reynolds's reproof is that Gainsborough saw nature with the eye of a painter and not a poet. It seems absurd to us to blame a painter for seeing with the eye of a painter. But we have been, through the experience of Constable and the 19th century, with its climax in the French Impressionists. That has changed our views.